Bartleby by Herman Melville. I am a rather elderly man. The nature of my avocations for the last 30 years has brought me into more than ordinary contact with what would seem an interesting and somewhat singular set of men, of whom, as yet, nothing that I know of has ever been written. I mean, the law copyists or scriveners. I have known very many of them, professionally and privately, and if I pleased, could relate diverse histories at which good-natured gentlemen might smile and sentimental souls might weep. But I waive the biographies of all other scriveners for a few passages in the life of Bartleby, who was a scrivener, the strangest I ever saw or heard of. While of other law copyists I might write the complete life, of Bartleby nothing of that sort can be done. I believe that no materials exist for a full and satisfactory biography of this man. It is an irreparable loss to literature. Bartleby was one of those beings of whom nothing is ascertainable, except from the original sources, and in his case those are very small. What my own astonished eyes saw of Bartleby, that is all I know of him, except indeed one vague report which will appear in the sequel. Ere introducing the scrivener as he first appeared to me, it is fit I make some mention of myself, my employés, my business, my chambers, and general surroundings, because some such description is indispensable to an adequate understanding of the chief character about to be presented. In primis, I am a man who, from his youth upwards, has been filled with a profound conviction that the easiest way of life is the best. Hence, though I belong to a profession proverbially energetic and nervous, even to turbulence at times, yet nothing of that sort have I ever suffered to invade my peace. I am one of those unambitious lawyers who never addresses a jury, or in any way draws down public applause, but in the cool tranquillity of a snug retreat, do a snug business among rich men's bonds and mortgages and title deeds. All who know me consider me an eminently safe man. The late John Jacob Astor, a personage little given to poetic enthusiasm, had no hesitation in pronouncing my first grand point to be prudence, my next method. I do not speak it in vanity, but simply record the fact that I was not unemployed in my profession by the late John Jacob Astor, a name which I admit I love to repeat, for it hath rounded and orbicular sound to it, and rings like unto bullion. I will freely add that I was not insensible to the late John Jacob Astor's good opinion. Some time prior to the period at which this little history begins, my avocations had been largely increased. The good old office, now extinct in the state of New York, of the Master in Chancery, had been conferred upon me. It was not a very arduous office, but very pleasantly remunerative. I seldom lose my temper, much more seldom indulge in dangerous indignation at wrongs and outrages. But I must be permitted to be rash here, and declare that I consider the sudden and violent abrogation of the office of Master in Chancery by the new constitution as a premature act, inasmuch as I had counted upon a life lease of the profits, whereas I only received those of a few short years. But this is my way. My chambers were upstairs, at number blank Wall Street. At one end, they looked upon the white wall of the interior of a spacious skylight shaft, penetrating the building from top to bottom. This view might have been considered rather tame than otherwise, deficient in what landscape painters call life. But if so, the view from the other end of my chambers offered at least a contrast, if nothing more. In that direction, my windows commanded an unobstructed view of a lofty brick wall, black by age and everlasting shade, which wall required no spyglass to bring out its lurking beauties, but, for the benefit of all near-sighted spectators, was pushed up to within 10 feet of my window panes, owing to the great height of the surrounding buildings and my chambers being on the second floor. The interval between this wall and mine not a little resembled a huge square cistern. At the period just preceding the advent of Bartleby, I had two persons as copyists in my employment, and a promising lad as an office boy. First, Turkey. Second, Nippers. Third, Ginger Nut. These may seem names, the like of which are not usually found in the directory. In truth, they were nicknames, mutually conferred upon each other by my three clerks, and were deemed expressive in their respective persons or characters. Turkey was a short, pursy Englishman of about my own age, that is, somewhere not far from 60. In the morning, one might say his face was of a fine, florid hue, but after 12 o'clock meridian, his dinner hour, it blazed like a grate full of Christmas coals, and continued blazing, but, as it were, with a gradual wane, till 6 o'clock p.m. or thereabouts, after which I saw no more of the proprietor of the face, which, gaining its meridian with the sun, seemed to set with it, to rise, culminate, and decline the following day, with the like regularity and undiminished glory. There are many singular coincidences I have known in the course of my life, not the least among which was the fact that exactly when Turkey displayed his fullest beams of his red and radiant countenance, just then too, at that critical moment, began the daily period when I considered his business capacities as seriously disturbed for the remainder of the 24 hours. Not that he was absolutely idle or averse to business then, far from it. The difficulty was, he was apt to be altogether too energetic. There was a strange, inflamed, flurry, flighty recklessness of activity about him. He would be incautious in dipping his pen into his inkstand. All his blots upon my documents were dropped there after 12 o'clock meridian. Indeed, not only would he be reckless and sadly given to making blots in the afternoon, but some days he went further and was rather noisy. At such times, too, his face flamed with augmented blazonry, as if cannel coal had been heaped on anthracite. He made an unpleasant racket with his chair, spilled his sandbox, in mending his pens, impatiently spilt them all to pieces, and threw them on the floor in a sudden passion, stood up, leaned over his table, boxing his papers about in a most indecorous manner, very sad to behold in an elderly man like him. Nevertheless, as he was in many ways a most valuable person to me, and all the time before 12 o'clock meridian was the quickest, steadiest creature, too, accomplishing a great deal of work in a style not easily to be matched. For these reasons, I was willing to overlook his eccentricities, though indeed occasionally I remonstrated with him. I did this very gently, however, because, though the civilest, nay, the blandest and most reverential of men in the morning, yet in the afternoon he was disposed, upon provocation, to be slightly rash with his tongue, in fact, insolent. Now, valuing his morning services as I did, and resolved not to lose them, yet at the same time, made uncomfortable by his inflamed ways after 12 o'clock, and being a man of peace, unwilling by my admonitions to call forth unseemly retorts from him, I took upon me one Saturday noon, he was always worse on Saturdays, to hint to him, very kindly, that perhaps, now that he was growing old, it might be well to abridge his labours. In short, he did not need to come to my chambers after 12 o'clock, but dinner over, he best go home to his lodgings and rest himself till tea-time. But no, he insisted upon his afternoon devotions. His countenance became intolerably fervid, and he oratorically assured me, gesticulating with a long ruler at the other end of the room, that if his services in the morning were useful, how indispensable, then, in the afternoons.
"With submission, sir," said Turkey on this occasion. "I consider myself your right-hand man. In the morning, I but marshal and deploy my columns, but in the afternoon, I put myself at their head and gallantly charge the foe thus."
And he made a violent thrust with the ruler. "But the blots, Turkey," intimated I.
"True, but with submission, sir, behold these hairs. I am getting old. Surely, sir, a blot or two of a warm afternoon is not to be severely urged against grey hairs. Old age, even if it blot the page, is honourable. With submission, sir, we both are getting old."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.